is that I don't even know what she's going to say next. And she has it on. She's one of the very few people that can act. Now, she cracks me for sure. I laugh my ass off, but she can actually make me speechless. And it's shocking because, you know, I have such a big ass mouth, but it's true. You can actually do it.
Well, I say things that you just don't know what the hell to say back to.
Well, sometimes there's no comeback. Like,
I'm like, and your brain's going, what is politically correct to say to her?
No, I know. No. See, I never worry about politically correct. See, it's not about political correctness. It's about, is there a way I can win? Because is there a way, if I respond to this, is there a win somewhere in this? And if there's
not.
Any, no, that's the thing, right? So there's not. So I work at a hockey arena as my side gig right now.
Yep.
And the one person's got one. My boss was right there, and the person that gives me the general, like, what I'm supposed to do, goes, "How good are you?" And even my boss is looking like, "How do you answer that question? Like, how do you even answer that question?"
Because I'm really good. That's all you say. How good am I? Well, see, I am the best you've ever had.
Because it comes with a. How do I put this? It comes with a. It's a loaded question because mm-hmm. I don't know. There's something else that's going to come after this. Since mm-hmm. I don't know what's going to come after this, I'm like, I don't know how to answer this question. How would you like me? Even my boss is like, yeah, I know. That's a loaded question. You can't win either way. If you say you're great and you can't do it, you fucked. If you say you suck, they're going to say, well, you know, you can't
Why
win.
Do we have you here?
Exactly. So it's just like, can't win. So if you have this ability to put me in can't win situations, it's like I can't, it's not politically correct. I've never worried about political correctness.
Okay.
Because I just realized I younger me would have been a little bit more concerned about pissing people off. I didn't necessarily want to rattle cages. Not because I still really don't like to do it, mm-hmm. but I also just don't care anymore. Like, yeah. There's just like I'm a
static queen right now. Sorry, my hair's starting to go like this.
It's okay. It's all good. Listen, Dr. Frankenstein. You it's a lie.
I'm like, what the hell's going on? This is why I don't like seeing pictures of myself, people. You know, because I start to go, wait, what's wrong? Where's that?
Yeah, you're just doing whatever, right? And you get to notice yourself and all the flaws, right?
Yeah. Oh yeah, there's so many flaws.
it's best not to do that. Instead, focus on the task at hand, right?
Yes.
But exactly. I just learned a long time ago that even when I was younger, people generally don't care. As I've gotten older, there's a balance. Like, you try not to judge anybody, but at the same mm-hmm. time, you just realize, like, at some point in this journey, like, it doesn't matter what I say, I'm pissing somebody off.
Pretty much, yes.
So fuck it, right? Now, I want to win if at all possible. I mean, I like that because it means it's less of a I'm screwed kind of thing. Like, you know,
yes.
But I don't. Yeah, no. I think political correctness is probably one of the worst things we've ever come up with.
Yes, it is.
Yeah, sorry. It's one of the worst. I would just rather call a spade a spade. Like, I don't want to hurt anyone's feelings. I mean, if anyone's listening to this, that's not what I mean. It's just there comes a point where you just got to be honest about what's in front of you and trying to always be delicate around an idea. Just say what you believe it to be.
Right.
Be open to being corrected and just live and let live.
Right. Exactly. And if you're new at something, you know, learn.
Yeah.
Don't think you know more than somebody else. Just shut up and learn.
See, younger me had that problem. Younger me that had that problem. Older me still thinks he's sometimes smart. Older mm-hmm. me also realizes that he can be humbled and has been humbled quite a few times.
Yes. And right? Asking questions is okay. But you know, thinking you know something, actually with age, you start to understand how little you know.
Yeah, no, it's true. I think the only things I hold true, like I really 100% believe with every single person on the planet, is we are responsible for our own actions and we need to be accountable for our own actions. And we have to be mm-hmm. self-aware enough to be accountable for them.
Yeah.
Once you get to that kind of beyond that, I have no idea what your day is like. So, I mean, do you get right down to it? I don't know, right? If I think if you break that little that standard I have, like that's a very simple little standard, actions and accountability. Mm-hmm. If you break that standard, I worry about you. But mm-hmm. right, because that means there's usually at least within yourself a level of dishonesty or an incredibly lack of self-awareness. I'm not sure which. Right, I'll give people the benefit of the doubt on that one, but that's the biggest thing I've learned is like that I can understand because I can look at myself honestly and go, okay, did I do this right? Did I do this wrong? Mm-hmm. Could I have done more and reasonably more, not perfection more? Like, could I have done more? And that's all I look at. Like, everything else is okay. I've been doing this advertising thing for nearly a year, up and down. Mm-hmm. I'm making a show. I know mm-hmm. it's going to work, how it's going to work. Shrug. Mm-hmm. Right? It was like mm-hmm. one of those shruggy moments. Right? But I put myself out there. And that's all you can do. And you move on to the next thing. It seems my true calling is to make shows for other people. That seems to be what I'm doing right now.
Yes. That's right. Good.
Yeah.
That's always fun. It absolutely is.
It's a lot of work too. Holy crap. Yes. Because I directed it and produced it. Mm-hmm. And I didn't host it. Like it's like okay. And that was a challenge in and of itself because my client, because of her expertise, needed mm-hmm. to host the show.
Okay.
She's comfortable in her expertise, not yep. so comfortable with everything else. So I've been kind of coaching her I never realized that, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Joshua Pentelaresco, is a skill. I never thought really? Of it. Yeah, she's
introducing yourself?
Yeah, no, she struggles with, like, I say this honestly, like, she struggles with the intro. She overthinks. What happens yep. is she overthinks the intro and she overthinks the outro.
Okay.
Right? Right? So people do that. It's one of those things where you just got to look at, like, what people are great at. She's comfortable in teaching environment where she's teaching yeah. people, but going up there and introducing yourself, there's just for whatever reason, she wants to make it more elaborate or the really, really meticulousness. And it's just, and I say this with all the love in the world, because honestly, that's part of my job is I'm here to coach her to do better at that.
Yes. Yes. Well, there was a time that I wouldn't have been able to come on here without, you know, babbling aimlessly or not being able to talk at all or completely freezing in front of the camera.
Yeah.
You know, just like, you know, deer in the headlights. Oh my God.
Oh yeah. No.
Nothing's coming out.
like public speaking is a legit fear. Like it's a legit fear. And one of those things, like me personally, I've been through so many things in public that it mm-hmm. at this point, I mean, I'm not saying it's impossible to embarrass me. But it's hard. It's really, really hard.
I can find ways.
Well, I'm sure there are, but I gotta warn you, that bar's
pretty high.
Yeah,
or pretty low. Whichever one you want to look at.
Yeah. Either way, depending on how you look at it. Yeah, it's high. I'm not saying it's impossible because I will never. I have learned this. Never say never. But it requires some real like.
Yeah. I mean, the on-air thing went on when I was on the radio the first time, and I was supposed to do the news. Nothing came out of my mouth. Mm-hmm. I just solidly froze. So I understand the overthinking or just, you know, the freeze, but age kind of diminishes that. It's like,
well,
it's actually the attitude. Who cares?
Well, actually, so the real secret to like a public performance, and this is something that people, there's two things people need to realize. One, people are here to see you. Yes. Like, it really doesn't matter what you do up there. They're here to see you. Right. Yes. Right. Right. Mm-hmm. And it's the second part that's most important. They're here for you. They don't care what you do. And I don't mean that in the sense of they do care about you. Mm-hmm. But the actual whatever you come up with is secondary, right? That's what I mean. And the second thing is, if you realize that, like you, there are no mistakes up there. You can actually, I worry about a perfect performance. Like, yeah, right. I worry about them because there's a certain meticulousness that's required to get to that level. And even then, there's these little errors, mm-hmm. right? I think the errors are part of the charm to me personally. Mm-hmm. So I want a professional level, not a perfect level. Does that make sense?
Yes. Yes. Although if you have a time crunch, the perfect, you know, you want the professional perfect.
you do, but it does, but you don't. Like, you usually have to have a bit of a trade-off, like, because it's mm-hmm. like, if you, especially if you are in a time crunch, it's yes. like, you're not going to get it all. What you need to figure out at that point is what's important to whatever presentation you're doing. What's the important part, and focus on that.
Yes. Well, and delivery, you know,
yeah.
making sure the delivery gets your point across. So
yeah, that's it. Yes. That's it. It's not, again, this is stuff I thought was simple, but apparently like
it isn't. It's a little bit more in depth than you.
Yeah. Than but I've been doing it for so long. I don't even think about it anymore. Mm-hmm. Right. So it's like, I just do it. I just, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So. I mean, being on the show with Katie for so many years has made me just, I'm fine in front of the camera. This is me.
Yeah.
This is all me. This is no makeup. I did do my hair today. So
my thumbs boss up for that one, ladies and gentlemen.
My boss on my one-on-one with her this morning, she's like, did you do something with your hair? I said, I blew dry it. I actually did something with it today. And she started laughing.
Yeah, because you just don't give a shit. You just don't give a shit. And that's it's the best. If you can have that attitude when you're up on stage like that, I'm just going to be me. I'm going to let what mm-hmm. happens. It's yeah. the best attitude. It legitimately is, because at that point, you can make all the mistakes in the world and mm-hmm. everyone will forgive you because of the way you carry yourself. It's actually a wonderful thing.
Yeah.
It's when you.
Yeah. I know people who are like, I can't go on the thing, 'cause I haven't, you know, spent hours on my face. I'm like, this is it. This is me, like it or not.
I don't give a shit.
I don't want to show my face anymore. Sorry.
I always worry about too much makeup, honestly. Mm-hmm. Like, I think there's a fine line. There's a really, really fine line with it. Like, a little bit, sure. I like I said, whatever. I mean, enhance certain features, go mm-hmm. with certain things. If you're trying mm-hmm. to present a particular look for a particular reason, I totally get it.
Yeah.
But there's a point too. It's like, I want to see something real on that face. Just mm-hmm. something. Just something,
yeah,
right.
I mean, I should do something with my eyes to highlight them, but then I rub them and it gets in my eyes, and it's just such a pain in the ass. Sorry. And my eyes is like this, and it just doesn't work.
I just see it. I could now I have this imagination that if we ever do an interview with eyeline, you're just gonna go have this moment where you're like, oh, my eyes, and I'm gonna be like, yeah, and I'll be like,
tears are running down my face.
And I'll be like, well, I don't know what to do here, honestly, folks. I don't know. I want to say there, but she might get mad at me for that because she's kind of in real pain right now.
Yeah. If anybody in the audience has ever gotten moisturizer or thing, I've gotten moisturizer in my eye before, and it gets red and it just burns. You know, just drips water down my face until I, you know, flush it out. But it's just like, it's a pain.
Yeah. So it's like, hi. It's like, oh my God. No, I get it. I totally get it. It's one of those things, like, when I do this, I accept that people are going to be who they are. Mm-hmm. There's no mistakes. And mm-hmm. I try to make people feel as loosey-goosey as possible. I mean, we just talked about most generation are making you cry. So, I mean, this is the yes. kind of show this is.
Yes.
Yeah. I'm going to miss this iteration of the show. Like, I'm working on taking down the show on the road. I'm not sure when exactly it's going to happen. So here's what I'm trying to do. Like, I'm mm-hmm. trying to set myself up now for the next 2 months that mm-hmm. my freelancing will cover my expenses on the road.
Good.
That's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to save up for a van. It's going to be a van.
Okay.
It's going to be a Mystery Machine style van. I may or may not put in a horn that actually generates ice cream music. I'm 50-50 on that debate. I'm 50-50 on that debate. Cool. Because here's the thing.
Paint it as the Mystery Machine?
No.
Oh, come on.
I'll give you a legit story. True story. I've seen it. Okay. I've seen people do it. Okay. I have seen three Mystery Machines in my life. One of them in London, Ontario. London, Ontario was the first time I saw it. It was it would regularly show up throughout London's neighborhoods. You could actually legit, I'm not shitting you, like a Mystery Machine. I've seen it in Vancouver. Now here's the really scary, terrifying part. What if it's the same machine? I don't think so, but what if? Because I've traveled all these places, it's possible someone else has. I've seen it in Arizona too. I saw it in Arizona. So I've seen three Mystery Machines. I could swear they're different cars. I can't say 100% for sure, but probably. And it's one of those situations where I've seen it. No, what I want to do, like, I don't know if I get to the paint job right away, but what I want to do is I want to paint my podcast logo on it. That's what I want to do short term. Maybe get upgrade to one of those camper vans eventually. Like I go through going pieces, kind of just see where it goes. Kind of see where all my contracts land, like all my contracts. You're right.
You know, the painting it, you can get the magnets. You know, a big magnet that you can just put on the side.
That's
true. My husband did that with his truck when it was tailored home improvement. So
I got to figure out how much that would cost. That's interesting. That's an interesting idea.
It's not well. He didn't have a huge thing, but yeah.
No, mine would be. I can see mine being a couple $100 to do that because it's about a couple $100, I figure. No, we got to, like I said, I'm trying to figure out all the little pieces on the journey. That's the next 60 days. I don't know by 60 days from now, I'll know when I'm going, how I'm going. Right. And everything else. I was hoping May looks more realistically like July or August, realistically. Like I said, I'm at the point where my freelancing regularly gets me at around $1,000 a month regularly, which is that's good, but it's not enough. I need to get myself. I need another grand somehow, some way in this. So maybe it's another show, producing another show. Maybe it's doing something else. I don't know. I have to think about that a little bit more. Right. But that's where I'm at. Like I'm at the point where I'm just trying to set myself up with enough different jobs. That I'm doing things while I'm on the road, also expand my business stuff as I go. And that's going to be the plan. I'm going to be a business.
So where are you going to go on the road?
So the first place is going to be Vancouver, British Columbia. It's going to be my test run. It's going to be my test run. It's going to be the one where I do the full trip, come back, to work out any bugs in the system. I'm hoping to do that. I'm going to cross my fingers when I say this, June. That's when I hope to do this Vancouver run.
Okay, because I will be in Vancouver, just going from the boat to the airport. When? Hold on. When?
Vancouver's awesome.
Yep. July 22nd.
Okay.
Is when I am in Vancouver, going from the cruise lines to the airport.
We'll see. So here's the thing. The second trip is going to depend. So I have confirmation from Marissa Mayer said yes, so I may go to Washington next.
Okay.
Or I may go to San Diego. I actually have an invite to go to the San Diego Comic-Con this year.
Ooh, that's awesome.
Yeah.
That's really awesome. I would go to San Diego.
It's true. But again, what I would do there is, because again, I've been doing a column for firstcomicsnews.com, so I have access to all the comic shows, all of them, as a media guest. I media, who knew, right? But so that's kind of like so I'm looking at this honestly as next 2 months are going to determine everything before when I'm going to get started. But yeah, the first trip's going to be Vancouver because it's a good test run. The second trip will be probably like, California or Washington. The third trip, I want it to be Arizona, and then the fourth trip, Colorado. I have a metal band I definitely have to see perform at some point in the journey. And then depending on how it all work, when I go, how it all works out, blah 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 blah, go back east to see my grandmother.
Where's your grandmother?
Detroit, Michigan.
Okay. Not really east. I mean east.
No. Let's be perfectly clear from a geographical standpoint, ladies and gentlemen. Mm-hmm. This is east for me. Because yes. the distance between you and Detroit is less than distance from me to Detroit.
Oh, right? I'm sure.
Yeah, right? So I show up there. I see my grandma. When I was living in Windsor, my grandmother was in Detroit, mm-hmm. and I couldn't go see her because of the pandemic. It was mm-hmm. brutal because, like, legitimately, 15 miles was the difference. Like that. Wow. That is it. It wasn't like a big difference. Mm-hmm. It was 15 miles, and if an imaginary line, I couldn't see my grandmother, and that killed me. That sucked. Yeah, that killed me. I saw everybody else. I saw everybody else I wanted to see, or that was wanting to see me. I could see. I mm-hmm. could not. Oh my God, I was so mm-hmm. that choked. That really choked me
that
up.
Did.
Because choked me up. I want to see her this year before at some point and actually spend some time with her. Mm-hmm. After that, like, I don't know. Like, it's gonna be up in the air. I might go to Ohio. I have friends in Ohio. I hear I'm invited to come to Maine at some point, somewhere in the mm-hmm. journey as well. Mm-hmm. But the other factors are going to be
New Hampshire, depending upon what time of year it is.
Yes. So now that I do know this, my goal is to spend the winter in California because I would rather not deal with the snow, right? And yes.
We haven't had a lot. I think you guys up that way, up in the Canadian Rockies and whatnot, have gotten pounded.
So this year has been actually incredibly nice.
Oh, good.
So we had a week of mine. So you remember that Arctic front that came mm-hmm. you guys' way? We got it first. We got the -50 weather.
Yeah. Yes.
And then you all got it. And we mm-hmm. were like, you're welcome. And also we're laughing at you all because we experience it all the time.
Yeah, I know you guys do.
Yeah. So
not the negative 108.
Yeah.
Wind chill.
So right this minute, it's 2 degrees Celsius. So to put that in Fahrenheit, it's about 36, 37 degrees.
Okay. Yeah.
And it's been around 40, 45 degrees regularly this mm-hmm. winter. We have not had fingers crossed, because we might get one more snap, but we are in February, which means that for us, usually by this time, fingers crossed, right? Fingers mm-hmm. crossed. We usually have a cold snap in January, and we have a cold mm-hmm. snap, and sometimes we have a small cold snap in February. It's possible mm-hmm. we get another cold snap in February, mm-hmm. but we had our cold snap in December. So
I keep laughing and telling Darren we're going to get pounded with snow while we're on our Caribbean cruise.
Yes.
Which is the beginning of March. We've only gotten out once on the snowmobiles.
Yes. Yeah, it's been a sucky year for that.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's been mild for the places that normally get the winters, and people that don't normally get the winters have been pounded. It's been funny. Right? It's been funny. Right? Yes. So, it's been funny. Like I'm grateful for the fact that, again, it's been like 40, 42 degrees the last 2 days. It's going to go back mm-hmm. up there tomorrow. So we don't have a minus like one or 30 degree day until I think next week. I mean, that's right. So, and it's like -1. It's not even I can wear a sweater out there. Like guys, and for those people listening, if you're used to really cold weather, unless it gets below -10, you don't even bother. I'm just telling you that straight up.
Right. Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah.
I've gotten used to more colder weather living up here. I went out the day that it was, the sub-zero, and I went to the grocery store because I went to the library because I had to give a stack of books that I donated to the library because I'm cleaning my shelves.
Yeah.
and then I went to the grocery store with my mother-in-law. Now, going from the grocery store to the car, we were in the full force of the wind, and it was just a little nippy.
When
your entire nose freezes, that's just...
Oh, yeah. No, that happened, right? But you know this as well as I do. Like, when you go through that, Like, so when we had the minus 50 days, I had to be outside every single day. Except for like a cut last half of the week. First half of the week, I'd be out there in it. Last half, I didn't, but the first half, I did. And oh my God, I would go out and I'd be out there for about 20, 25 minutes. And then I'd have to go inside for about 20, 25 minutes because it was that cold. It was that cold out there.
Any exposed skin gets, you know, you have to get
it's weird because again, I spent 10 years working in a trailer and in that weather sometimes too. So you get you get used to it, right? You learn how to insulate a little bit, but you get like cold doesn't bother me like it did when I was younger. Right? So, but I don't necessarily want to expose myself to more rounds of it, like, you know, anymore. I'm at that point in my life where, you know, I can go to a beach. I'll go to a beach, right? I mean, that's just that's where I'm at. But it's not that, again, I hate it here exactly. But for me, the other aspect of this, I wrote about this in my blog. It's just reconnecting with people has not been what I expected it to be. I figured people would be more. It would be more open or eager to it, but everybody I reached out to, it just didn't happen for whatever reason. Yeah. So I just took it as a sign up for what it was. Like, okay, well, you don't want to, or you don't have to, like whatever the case may be, right? I learned probably the most important lesson I learned in 2022 is you can't wait for anybody. You just can't.
Right.
And this is why, because by the time people are making up their minds, like life keeps happening. So, you have to go forward.
Exactly.
That was my 2022. That was my 2020. That was my 2022. My 2023 is going to be adventure and connection. That's been my theme for the year. So.
Yeah, 2023 for me is I've got nothing scheduled on the book side except for one that I have to do for October. So I'm just like, yeah.
You're going to have some fun this year.
Confetti and just relax. I've been writing, I've been formatting, like, you know, the mad woman trying to get everything in hardcover.
Yes,
that's why my shelves are shrinking, because I'm keeping the hardcover copies and getting rid of all the individual paperbacks.
That's awesome.
Yep. So
that's awesome.
My local library got two series. So
no, that's cool. I'm like I said, it's been funny. I have to finish this up. I've been gradually just shrinking my book collection. Yours is still there. I have your book actually, you know, on my shelf because I've read. So it's interesting. I have all my books to read not on the shelf. Mm-hmm. When I finish them, I put them on the shelf. So this is what I'm currently reading.
Okay.
Right. That's what I'm currently reading.
Yeah.
That's a good book. Very, very good book. I get Judas Contract vibes. That's a comic book reference, but I get Judas Contract vibes from it. It's one of those, like, I'm reducing everything while I'm here, and I'm just shrinking things down. It's not that I have, like, it's been absolutely nobody. There are people I have seen, but the amount of connections I had and the amount that I've reached out to that it's been a lot smaller than I expected. I think part of it too, and this is something I just came to the conclusion. Maybe it's me. The fact of where I'm at as a person at this point in life too. I'm trying to do something very hard, turning my passions into a career. And maybe the separation is just so it happened. I don't know. What do you think?
I don't know. I have no, I mean, you know, when I go home, actually, we've connected with all our friends at different times. We went to, you know, one of our friends moved to Delaware. We stopped and stayed at their house when we were going down to North Carolina. So, you know, we got to see their house. Our other friends are actually coming up here next weekend because they haven't seen this house. They haven't come up and seen where we now live. They had come to Connecticut once. So that's going to be nice. But you know, when I go back to Connecticut, it's tough because everybody's busy, and you know, if you don't plan ahead, Oh, but, you don't get in.
No, it's true. No. But that's the interesting thing. I'll make these plans.
Yes.
And they'll fall through. Like they'll just like, right? No. I'm at that point. Like I'm at that point in my life. Hi, my life. This is it. I'm an adult. This is my actual legit scheduler.
Yeah. No. Mine is all here. Mine is all on Google Calendar.
No, it's fair. No,
your picture's up there because that's the last one. Yeah.
I just, again, it's an adult thing. Like you have to schedule things now. And
yeah.
And
if it's not on my calendar, it doesn't get done.
Yeah, and
I know that's the same with Katie.
Well, no, it's because you get gone. It's just how life goes. You got things to do. Like tomorrow, like, okay, so today when I'm done here, I finished the rough cut of episode 3 of the series I'm working on. It's a rough cut. So I send it to my client. Mm-hmm. If she wants to add any voice recordings or anything extra to it, that like from the side, this is also where she can get her input. So I go edit. Then I do. So this is the way I do it. I do that. Then I do a proper edit. Give it to her again, just to make sure that she's happy with the cut. And if there's anything I miss, she'll catch it.
Yeah.
Right. It's just little things. Right. And, it's one of those, but again, that's where I'm at. Like I do that today. Tomorrow I'm ghostwriting a blog for a client now too, which is kind of fun. Mm-hmm. I get paid to write science fiction. And get about science fiction, I get paid to do it, which is great.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So I'm doing my first, that's going to be my day tomorrow. That's going to be my day tomorrow. And then I'm going to work on my novel. Mm-hmm. Friday, I go have coffee with a friend and then I go to work thereafter. Mm-hmm. I go back to the arena. I opened up my Saturday on purpose for the side gig because I get a feeling there's a gentleman that works there that hasn't exactly been the most reliable. So I figure I might keep myself open for an easy payday.
Yeah.
So I'll do that. And I work Sunday. And then next week, I'm not sure what I'm doing yet. I'm hoping to get myself another client between then and now. That's kind of like that's the goal. It's the other goal, but that's it. And then once everything's kind of established and done, like, yeah, I sound very boring, folks, but the truth is like it's
well, I'm going wedding dress shopping this weekend with my daughter-in-law. Or my daughter-in-law to be. She's not my daughter-in-law yet. It's easier just to say daughter-in-law.
it sounds like she's family already. Son's
fiance or daughter-in-law to be or whatever.
Yeah, which is fun. Yeah. She
was excited that, you know, she's like, would you want to come? And I said, I would love to. And she was excited. So I'm like, cool. Yeah. I get to be part of it.
Well, yeah. I mean, hey, why not, right? I mean, you are going to be not her mom, at least her mom-ish kind of person in her life.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. My daughter is her wedding planner and one of her bridesmaids. So.
Yeah. That's awesome.
Yeah, and Vicky did ask her, you know, do you want me to pick out some dresses for you? Because there may be some that I pick out that is not really your style, but I'm going to want you to try them on.
Yeah.
Because, you know, the wedding planner. Yes.
Wedding planner. Yes. Yes. Because wedding planner wants to eliminate all possibilities before she's like, I think this works, but I might have missed something. Right.
Right. That's exactly. Right. Yes. The ultimate planner.
I wonder where she got it from.
Huh. I don't know. I have no idea.
Yeah, no idea.
I don't plan though. Really, sort of. I just do.
I don't think you schedule things.
I just do it.
That's making a plan. I mean, I hate to break this to you. That's what a plan is. I'm gonna pick a time and I'm gonna do it. I mean,
yes.
That's a plan.
It's not elaborate. It's just, you know.
Okay. And that's fine. You're not an elaborate planner. So she took it to the next level. That's fine.
She took it like 10 levels.
Is your husband super organized?
Yeah, for the most part. But he's not a planner. He likes to do things at the spur of the moment sometimes. Yeah. He doesn't want everything planned out. He gets, you know,
anxious
by that.
Yeah, because that's I get that too. I like somewhere in the middle. I don't necessarily want everything nailed down to the absolute wall, but I also
minute by minute blows. Yeah.
Yeah, minute by I don't need no one needs that. Like no one does. Unless there's stupid money involved, I don't even want to even think about
My daughter does that for weddings.
Which means she's great at her job, but she probably has her moments where she just breaks down and cries in the corner sometimes because it's just like,
she's the best in a crisis.
Oh, I believe it.
She is the calm, you know, the calm when there's a storm going on, and then afterwards she picks out.
But yeah, no, again, that's what I think. Like she knows how to do that. She can put herself as the head. But I mean, there's got to be moments. I could just see it with your daughter where it'd be like, why me? At the end, it's all over, right?
Well, but she loves what she's doing, so that's good. And she's one of the top 10. I think she's like number 3 in Connecticut for wedding planners.
That sounds like, again, she was, I mean, just based on what she told me.
And she isn't even 30.
No, but God bless her. Okay. Other things she picked up from her mom. She's driven.
Yes.
She's very driven and she's ambitious and she's got a plan. And yes, she got some of that from you. Don't kid yourself. Yeah, right. But she's meticulous because, again, I get this too. She's meticulous because when you do an event, there's a lot of detail. I work at a hockey arena, so I get to watch every time I go to the game.
Mm-hmm.
Right, I get to see all the work that goes into just getting a game for people to enjoy themselves.
Right.
It's a lot of work. I don't think people realize just what goes into anything like that. And it takes a lot of detail, planning, staff, like minutia. Mm-hmm. And it takes a very specific kind of, again, it's not for everybody, but I mean, you got to love it. But I think that's true with everything. You got to love it at the end of the day.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I've done project management, and you know, which is the same type thing as you know, it is a big project, and
yes,
it's I mean, I was good at it apparently, but it was not my love.
No,
you know, I like being a business analyst in my day job. I get to write shit. It's dry as hell shit, but I get to write shit.
Well, actually, you know what? I would actually love as a challenge. Like insurance commercials, because they're actually fun, because they know their shit's boring. They know it.
Yeah.
They absolutely know it.
Yeah.
They're like, you know what? Fuck it. We're gonna have fun with this there's no other way to do it, right? And
there's no other way to get people's attention to think about, you know, especially stuff like life insurance or disability insurance and all of that. It's things that are necessary to keep.
Yeah.
You know, your loved ones safe and secure, but it's not something that you really want to think about.
Well, it's also no matter how you do it, no matter what end of the spectrum you're on, even the insurance people will tell you it's boring. It's boring. And I was, I will confess something. I think insurance is kind of a bit of a scam. Because it's the only thing you pay for that you actually, if you use it, you have to pay more.
For certain things, yes.
Yeah. It's one of those. It's the one thing I look at it and go, as a concept, it's a good idea, right? Yes. But sometimes when I look at the execution, I go, I think this is a bit of a cash grab. Not with everything, but some of it's like, some of it's like, I don't know, this was kind of cash grabby to me. I think I'm not going to do it. But I mean, maybe that'll get me in trouble, but you know.
You know, I've gotten to the point where I recommend collision because they will get rid of your car.
Yes, they
will. I did not have it. Collision. I had insurance, but I didn't have collision when I lost my car when I was younger. Much younger. Like in my, you know, early 20s, just first married. And the person who hit me didn't have insurance either, did not have any insurance. So that was even worse. So I had to figure out how to get rid of this dead car.
Yeah.
Thankfully, my father was in insurance, in property insurance. Thankfully.
So it worked out for you.
Yeah, I'm not in property. I work in I actually a broker dealer, so I'm a broker dealer business analyst. So I help the business people talk to the systems people, and I write the stuff down so both can understand it. So yes. So
basically, you're the layman. So you're the layman between.
I'm the translator.
Yeah, basically that's what you are. You're just like. I yeah. translate your shit because both of you are have specialized yourselves.
You know, they talk like this and it's a
blah, blah, blah. I don't understand you, but they don't want to say that to each other. So they go, could you just, what did he say?
What are the requirements? Right? what does the business guy want? What does the technical guy say? Yeah, that's me. So that's my day job. And then I come home and write at night.
See, you actually just gave me a horrible idea. I'm gonna tell you. Yeah. So
what?
I have a novel series right now that I'm hoping to get. I'm hoping to get the first book out this year.
Mm-hmm.
So it's called the first one's called Corey the Night Witch, and every one is gonna be Corey the something or else until the very last book. The last book is her full name. That's it. That's her title. That's the title, right? A fully realized character, like my little subtle saying, a fully realized character. And, but she's killing evil versions of the Knights of the Round. So Percival is a used car salesman / genie is what he is.
Okay.
And that's what he is. Like that's little, like I'm making him as obnoxiously punchable in the face as possible when he deals with people. Because I want him to get punched in the face. I'm not gonna lie. But what I could do is I could make another light like a knight, a legalese person that speaks in a language nobody understands. So he confuses people, right?
Yeah,
I mean he's an evil prick about it because he's telling you exactly what he's going to do. But if you don't understand him, right, bad things happen to you. But it's also kind of funny, and you just gave me an interesting way to beat him too. Because what I would do is the opponent would be someone he can't understand.
Mm-hmm.
Right, and he's just like he's a specialist. He's a specialist. And folks, yes, my mind does work this way. I do.
That's all right. Yeah. That's okay.
Yes.
The only book I have to write this year is about a supernatural assassin. So
you'll like my book. I should get you to beta read this one when it's done.
Sure.
She's not really a supernatural assassin, but she was an assassin. And she still kills people. She just tries to kill the right people. And
okay.
That's the difference.
She's got a moral compass now.
She's trying to. Actually, that's sort the whole. But that's the whole story. I'm really fascinated with this idea of how much we can change as people. And one of the things I realize is like there are some parts of us that don't change, and there's some parts of us that do.
Yeah.
And that are capable of changing. And the thing about that is, the interesting thing about that to me is, it's like, okay, if you go so far down the wrong path, can you turn it around? And what does that actually look like, right? If you do, because again, I think everybody has this ability to, I'm not the same person I was 5 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm not that different, but I am different.
Mm-hmm.
I'm very different than the person I was 10 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And when I go to my next 5 years, which if all things considered, I'll probably, if all goes to magical plan, I'll have figured out where the hell I belong and settle down somewhere and hopefully I'll be nice and warm and I'll be making piles and piles of money. But even if not, it doesn't mean a place where I kind of feel like this is my home. This is where I'm going to like make that decision. It's the other part of the reason I'm doing this trip, because I really don't know where I fit. And I just know that it's not anywhere I've been. So I got to go find something new, right? So, you know, and put myself out there and kind of see where I end up. But that's my future. But right this minute, it's like that guy, when in 5 years, is going to be a very different guy than the guy that's here right now. And I'm like, if I were to go completely off the beaten path, because it would be very easy for me to do, could I come back? What does that look like if I do try to come back? Right? And no matter what, because no matter what, there's two things about that. No matter the terrible things I've done will always stick with me. No matter how much I try to walk away from them. Can I make peace with that? I don't know. I think that's an interesting story.
And then, and you know, and then there's the God angle. It depends on what you believe, and you know, there are certain different faiths that believe, you know, if you cross this line, you can never come back. And then there are other parts of the faith that believe that if you believe in Jesus or believe in God, you will be saved. I'm not sure where I land on that.
So here's, this is why it's important. So from a biblical standpoint, this is why I don't judge people, because I can't make that decision.
Right.
Nor can anyone. What I can, I tend to believe that, okay, you could break the Bible down to three verses.
Yeah.
Three things. Jesus was asked about the Ten Commandments way back in a parable. And the parable was, well, what are they? Believe in God.
Yep.
Honor thy neighbor. Love thy brother. I struggle with number three. So now I really struggle with number three.
Yep.
But number one and two, I again, that's a simplified version of the Bible. Now,
right. Those are the three, you know, prime thing. You know?
Well, it's I'm
love your God, love your neighbor, love yourself.
Love thy brother, right? It doesn't necessarily love thyself. Yeah. Love thyself.
Love thy neighbor. Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Right. So, it's one of those things where, when you read that, okay, that's not a huge line. And on one hand, it's not a huge line. On the other hand, you think about that in like the depth of that. That's a huge line, right?
Yes.
That's a huge line. Depending on how you view it. I meet all walks of life on this show. And one of the things I realized is I don't know the steps they took to get to this point.
Right.
And because I really don't know, and even if I did know, their decisions are based on their experiences, their perceptions, their ideals of how the world is. Ergo, I am not qualified. I'm just not qualified to give a proper judgment call to each and every. Now, again, I will call you out on your actions. I will make you accountable for your actions. But that's not the same thing as judging you.
It's not. It's, you know, it's saying it's saying the truth of the matter.
Yeah.
Or the truth the way you see it in some cases. So
yeah, oh, absolutely. Yeah. And again, there's room for interpretation too. Like there could be things I'm missing. There could be things. This is the whole point. So what I tend to look at I think intention is super important. I don't think it's the only thing, but intention is super important. If I'm trying to do the best I can every single day.
Right.
And there are just some days, and it doesn't matter who you are. There are some days you just get your ass kicked. It's just the way it is, right? Yeah. It's just the way it is.
Yeah.
There are some days you kick all kinds of ass, and there's no middle ground. Heck, you could argue that maybe I'm a sinner. I swear like a sailor. I've been profane pretty much for you don't give a shit. But some people would, right? There is such a wide variety when you look at Christianity.
Yeah, somebody would clutch their pearls hearing me speak.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So I'll tell you a funny story. So I was in a Mormon community in Arizona, and they invited me to play baseball. The first swing across the plate was strike two, and I went, "What happened to strike one? We don't do that here." Right? And it's like, okay, fine. I guess I'm swinging in the next pitch. So I swing and I foul the ball and I say, shit. And everybody went, right? And it was one of those moments, right? Just like, you know. So in the Bible verse for that, ladies and gentlemen, is new wine can't exist in an old skin. And there's merit in that. And people need to, sometimes when they put other people's shoes, that they need to remember that. Right? So I say it like that because so what I really look at with people is, are they doing the best they can?
Mm-hmm.
That's it. That's all I really look at. Are they trying to be accountable? Are they trying to hold themselves to some kind of standard somewhere over the rainbow? If they are, then what the fuck do I know? Right. That's right. And that's how I look at it. I don't have this tendency anymore of like, you're going to hell. I don't know. I really don't.
Right. Yeah, right. Exactly. Right? It's like, right. I think your intent is nefarious. You're not a good person. Stop.
Yeah.
Repent.
But the thing is, that's what also makes it really hard. You can't prove intentions. You really can't. No. Right? You can't. Well, so
you can with the callers that scam you, the scam calls. The intent of that is to defraud you out of something. So true, everybody absolutely. Who does that.
Yeah, but actions will give that away too, right? The actions of that will give that away. Mm-hmm. And that's all I can measure anybody by mm-hmm. is actions and their willingness to be accountable. That is it. That is all I can do.
Yes.
Now, having said that, right, that's my standard.
Mm-hmm.
It might be wrong. I'm a big enough man to admit it, right? All right, but that's all I look at with people. I don't look mm-hmm. at anything else because that will tell me everything I need to know about you, right? Mm-hmm. Right. That's how I decide if I'm going to do business with you. That's how I decide, like, if I'm going to hang out with you, right? Your intentions, your mm-hmm. your actions are going to say everything I need to know about you. Now, again. There's openings to interpretation on some of these actions too, because mm-hmm. I don't understand everything. But here's the deal: if you're accountable for what you do, mm-hmm. that's gonna pretty much like that's gonna like if I go to you, you did this, and you go, sure did.
Yes, I did. Sorry if it hurt you. Sorry if it bothered you, but yeah, that was me.
I think the only thing about that is the only thing about what you just said is I'm not sure you'd be sorry. I'd be like, right? It's like, sure did. And that'd be like the most honest answer, just succinct. It's like,
yeah. If you're bothered by something, I would feel a little, I would be truly, I'm sorry I hurt your feelings, but yeah, I did it.
it depends on what it is. Like for me, it depends. If you're judging me without like any real, did you do mm-hmm. this? Yes, you monster. Shrug. Like again, I've passed that. I'm past that point. I don't mm-hmm. care about that anymore. Mm-hmm. But it's you did this. Yes, it did. Why'd mm-hmm. you do it? And I'll tell you why. And sometimes, mm-hmm. sometimes I don't have a good reason. Most of the time I do, but sometimes I don't. You hear me out? Are you mm-hmm. again that right? I'll care more. Right? Again, these are just. I'm keeping this stupid simple, right? Yes. Because I don't. Again, this is the only thing. The older you get, the more you don't know.
Right.
Right. Right.
Right. Exactly.
Right. Right. So, I try not. Again, with everybody in their lives, right? Everybody's life is their own. I'm not here to tell people how to. Live. I try to inspire people. I try to encourage people.
Mm-hmm.
I am not a moral role model in the sense that I should be the guy you should. Again, I do my mm-hmm. own shit. I'm going to be the first to admit it. I do my own
mm-hmm.
shit.
Mm-hmm.
But what I will do is I will look at you and go, okay, this is what you did. Do you own it?
Mm-hmm.
That's all I give a shit about. It saves time. It like legitimately just saves time for me. And that's it.
So in turning that into fiction, how do you do a redemption arc with somebody who's, you know, or what people would view as irredeemable?
Exactly. And that's the fun part. And that's the fun part about the story is I'm doing that redemption arc. Some people will
it's their intention, the character's intention. If you can make it more honorable than, you know.
It's definitely like them. Even she could do absolutely nothing and be more honorable than where she was. That's the thing. That's the thing. Yeah. Like where she was in a pretty dark place.
Mm-hmm.
What comes after that is again, again, this idea of who she could be. Mm-hmm. I think that's the other thing too. We have this choice to be who we want to be. Mm-hmm. We really do. Like, for the most part, we have that choice. So the question then becomes, who do you want to be? Mm-hmm. And how much of that is in your own eyes important towards your destiny? Again, what is a good person? Mm-hmm. For my character, that's going to be a very different answer than maybe somebody that's done far less dumb shit. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
Right? Far less dumb, dark shit. It's a different answer.
Yeah.
But it might be her. Again, that's the real... Though challenge. Changing yourself for the better is never easy. Mm-hmm. Nor should it be, I don't know. Right? No. Nor should it be. You have to work at those things and be those things. And that's, I think that's the thing, a true redemption arc. There's going to be stories in this.
Yes.
She fails.
Yeah.
Epically,
oh yeah.
Epically. And what do you do? Like when you get knocked off the horse, right? It's not, we all do that. We got to get back up.
It's like you roll around in the mud for a little bit, and then you get up and clean up.
Pretty much. That's it, right?
Pretty much, yeah. And then, right? And then you choose to move forward. And it's giving the characters the strength to move forward is awesome, too. Especially, you know, when we see so many people nowadays that just are crippled by things and can't move forward and don't know how. Trying to show them how, from an irredeemable standpoint, I guess gives them hope too.
Well, that's the idea. Anyone, like, that's the thing, right? Like, if you look at it from the Bible says it like this, like, anyone can be saved. Anyone. Doesn't matter who you are.
Yeah.
Right. So if you believe that, then the question is, how do you do it? And again, this might sound like old Zen wisdom crap here, but I think at some point you have to confront that darkness inside you.
Oh yeah, you absolutely do.
Yeah, right. And what does that look like? And can you make peace with that demon in you? And if you can, there's hope for change. But you got to again, as you change, your demons change a little bit too.
Oh yeah, they don't ever go away.
No.
You know, we you know, as humans are, if in the biblical sense, we're all sinners at all levels, you know, so every day, you know, even thinking a nasty thought about somebody who did you wrong, that is a sin.
But
it's how you, if you voice it, it's even worse. But if you can, you know, not voice it and choose maybe kindness or say doing something out of generosity instead of, you know, being an ass. there's a baby step.
Sometimes I enjoy being an asshole. Sometimes, right?
Yeah.
There is a certain, especially again, going back to my little standard, if I feel like you're not going to be accountable for this ever. Mm-hmm. So why would I be kind? But again, that's a tricky balance too, right? Mm-hmm. Right? Because again, I truly think I believe in God, and I'm going to say it like this: if there is a God, right? I think much like a good book of fiction, it's not that you win battles or lose battles; it's who you are when things are hard. Mm-hmm. That is when your character really comes out. And again, there are things we all need to work on. And I understand that. But at the same time, I look at the last few years and who I chose to be in that time versus what a lot of other people chose to be. Mm-hmm. I think I'm a lot happier with the choices I made, and a lot of people are happier with theirs. Mm-hmm. Now, I say that Not because I think I'm better. I just, again, I made a conscious decision of who I was going to be during the pandemic.
Yeah.
And I don't know if everybody made those conscious decisions during it. I don't know if the decision was conscious. So I think what's happened, I think for a lot of people, especially the ones that were genuinely cruel, no matter what they saw, I think they're looking in the mirror and looking at some of those mistakes and going, well, what do I do now? Right. And that's kind of what I'm seeing that in little bits and little spots here. It's like, you know, I'm not sure I was right. I'm not sure I was this. I'm not sure I was that.
I was just unafraid.
Yeah. And I chose
to be unafraid because.
And I chose to be kind.
Yeah.
I chose to be kind. I chose me again. For me, the moment was Vancouver, actually in Vancouver, ironically enough. Mm-hmm. There's a gentleman. For people that want to, I've said this story on this podcast before, but for anyone that hasn't heard it, this was right when the pandemic, everything was starting to shut down. Mm-hmm. That's when that, right. Mm-hmm. So this is when everybody did not know. It was chaos. It was pure chaos. So I'm going home from work. I'm taking the train to work. And again, every day I'm going, I'm wondering if I'm even going to go. Now I'm wrapping my time up there too, which is a really weird kind of feeling too, because I just know I'm done.
Yeah.
Right. I'm done a little sooner than I wanted to be by a month because it doesn't matter. Like, I was coming to the end of my time there and I knew it deep down. So I was in a weird spot that way. But even so, I'm coming home from work. And on the way, I was at the train station downtown. There was a gentleman there. He goes, hey, yeah, this is rare. No one knew anything. No one. Mm-hmm. So he goes, you got a pencil or something? I'm going to work. You got a pencil or something I can draw? I mean, he's dirty looking. It looks like he's been on the street. That, again, in Vancouver, unfortunately, you can have a full-time job and still be on the streets.
Right, It's that expensive there.
Yes, it is. So he... he was like, I looked, and he goes, yeah. So he holds his fist like this. And I just realized like how cruel is this time? Like right when I hesitated, I was like, this is one of the cruelest moments in history. This is cruel. And I understood just how cruel this time was going to be. And I realized at that moment, it's like, I cannot be this way. So I gave him a fist bump right back. Like, you know what? I am going to be kind to everybody, no matter what. And I gotta be honest with you, in 2021 that was a much harder struggle for me than 2020 was, especially the end of it. But 2020 I did not hold anything against anybody. I can't say the same at the end of 2021, right? But I can say it in 2020 I didn't hold anything to anybody. Things were said
in 2020. I got into a fight with my sister and brother about my parents. My parents were going to help my daughter out because we were up here and she was moving and the move date was pushed back a week into the new house. And they had the closing with the old house and my parents have a basement and, you know, they asked if they could stay at their place and my sister got very upset because she didn't want my mom and dad exposed to anything. So she pulled my brother into it and he called and he was yelling at me. And I'm like, dudes, I'm in New Hampshire. and my daughter ended up not going there, not staying there. She went over to my brother-in-law's house because of that. And my parents were pissed. I had never heard my dad so upset. So that made me even more upset. And later when my sister and I started talking, she says, I know, I was just worried about mom and dad. I said, that's not why I was angry. I was angry because you went, you sabotaged it by having Doug call and scream at me instead of calling and talking to me. And Vicky was mad because her aunt didn't call and talk to her. It was just, and it was just driven on fear. And my parents did not go a week without seeing their great grandchildren.
Yeah, which is cool.
Because my daughter brought them over. They didn't post pictures on Facebook because they didn't want the wrath of
my
brother and sister. But you know. It was a tough time.
No, it was. It was. Mm-hmm. like, I mean, like I said, I mentioned my grandmother in Detroit. The only reason I didn't see her, to be honest, because I wasn't allowed to cross that border. We would have gone in, because again, there are lots of ways to die in a time like that.
Right.
And the worst of them is
loneliness.
It's loneliness.
Yes.
And people don't think, well, what about the place? Like, honestly, you know what? Straight up, right? There comes a point, you gotta look at this like, okay, say this is the end. Do you want your last moments not to see them?
Right.
Right. I mean, I went back home to see my family. Because again, that's what mattered. I got to see my sister. I got to see my dad. I got to see my other grandmother with her boyfriend. That was a hoot, let me tell you. I enjoyed those times.
Yeah.
They were precious. And again, the other thing too, and I'll say this, like, this isn't the first time and like there's been plagues and stuff like that. And again,
right.
Other countries have made peace. Like, I saw friends from other parts of the world that had to travel during 2020.
Yeah.
Just because childhood friends, because again, we know like there are things.
We moved.
Yeah. I moved three times during the pandemic. So, I mean, I know what it's like, right?
We moved. My daughter moved.
Yeah. Again, life goes on. Like, that's the thing, right? And again, people listening to this might be going, well, how can you just, like, it's not, there comes a point you can't, there's a risk, but there's always been a risk. There
walking
comes a
out
point.
The door, there's a risk. You could
slip
fall.
That's it, right? So, I mean, you have to make a decision, like, okay, acknowledge the risk, sure, but do you want to live in fear the rest of your life?
Right.
That's it, right? And again, I've seen what fear does to people. Fear destroys people. If you let it, like, it destroys people on the inside and out. And I've seen it over and over and over again. And it's the worst thing. I fear to me was the biggest killer of the pandemic, not the actual disease itself.
Right.
And right. Even now, like, again, I get this feeling that people are still, again, the psychological stuff is going to take a few more years to work out of everybody's system.
I think so.
Yeah.
I think so.
Let's go on a let's end on a happy note before we wrap this up, because I think you're taking a vacation. Is this a deliberate vacation from writing this year?
Sort of, because I've got a cruise in March.
Yes.
I have another cruise in July. I have my niece's wedding in August and my son's wedding in September. So, you know, I have those major things and I didn't want pressure. I have to write something. I have to write something, you know, I know Katie and I are going to try to write the trilogy this year.
Hey, Rebecca.
Hi, Rebecca. I hope you're feeling better.
Yeah, I hope so too. Hey, Rebecca, you know what? Seriously, I got to get you on the show at some point. I've never had you on the show. And the way this show is currently, absolutely.
Yeah.
Oh, it totally was. Yeah. But to me, I think people's reactions to each other was even worse than COVID was.
Yeah.
So that's my opinion. But Rebecca, I will say this. I should mention this right now. So. Oh.
Yes, she has it right now.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that.
Yeah. That's why I said I hope you feel better.
I
saw her a little, you know.
I got it. So Rebecca, I think I got it before everybody knew it. Cause I was in Vancouver in BC delivering, and we had this like weird flu going around January, February in 2020. It was weird, right? I got it. So I was over it in about 2 days.
Oh wow. I got it in 2021 before there was shots. So
I got it even before it was like announced.
Weeks. Yeah. I was down for 3 weeks.
I was down for 2 days. So I took this. This is called copper chloride.
Yeah.
And the first day it took me 3 days to get over it. I would have been fine too. I actually was good enough to, again, at the time, folks, no one knew what this was. I went back to work the second day. Right. My body was still like not 100%, but I wasn't like exhausted, tired or any of that anymore. I was recovering. So I took the third day off and I was good. Like, I was done. And it was over. I didn't have any taste bud issues. I didn't have any of that stuff. I just, mm-hmm. I took some copper throughout the day and I was, and it went to sleep and I was good. That was what I did.
Oh, right? My gosh. So
that's what I did. That's what I did for it, folks. That worked for me. And that, and the reason why I think it was COVID, because it was my first flu in like 20 years. I don't get flus. So, mm-hmm. I get colds once in a while, but I don't get flus. So, So, I mean, Becca, my best. If you can, try it. It does do wonders. Iodine's good too. So,
okay. But,
so my sister had it, and I had her put iodine under the nose. It actually cleared her breathing up. So, there's my family's naturopathic, so that's kind of okay. Why I go that route more than anything else, because it to me, I that's another conversation for another day. Yes. But that's
yes. But, we can talk about homeopathic remedies.
Yeah. I went the homeopathic. I did the absolutely. Absolutely. And the other thing you can do, Rebecca, if you got it, if you have peppermint, if you have peppermint will oxidize anything you put together with it. So take peppermint and put it with like anything you're using to fight it. Mm-hmm. You'll find it stronger. I would just, No. Mix. Don't mix it with your stuff. Don't put it separate. Mix it. Yeah. Right. Mix it. Don't do it separate. Make sure you mix it. The only caution is if you're taking any drugs, maybe not with the drugs, more the remedy stuff, like mix peppermint with it. It's potent shit. Yes.
Peppermint is my go-to for a lot of things.
No, it's good. So for me, it's my coffee. Like, so what I do is I put a little peppermint, and I usually put a tea bag in there, but I'll actually put in mint leaves if I have it, right?
Yeah.
Hey, Rebecca. So I'm going to call a number right now, and it's like, hey, listen, you might want to go to this house at this place at this time.
Yeah.
The pharmacy. But Rebecca, honestly, when you're well, message me, because this show is about going to evolve. I've never had you on the show, and I probably should remedy that before the show changes.
She probably will make you speechless too.
That'd be good.
I would bet on Rebecca. Sorry, my daughter was calling. I'm like, oh, nope. I told her I was on the show.
Yeah. So, okay. So you kind of chose vacation. You didn't want any pressure this year. Do you think you're going to release anything else this year besides the obligated book?
Well, Pack Magic just came out in the Shadows and Fate anthology. And then the paperback is out now too. So I got both of those out. I will probably have a couple more. I just am not planning on dates. I'm not scheduling editors this year. I'll go back to normal next year. So, you know, yes.
sometimes. Oh, I'll let you in on a little secret, Rebecca. I actually have said this to Jane off the show. I might make Jane speechless here. She's actually an amazing writer. I really, really thoroughly enjoy her work. I had the pleasure to advertise, not for this work, but for a previous work of hers. I had to read it, and she was really good. I'm enjoying her Dragon Tempest series. That's my favorite of her stuff. Mm-hmm. But she writes a lot of good books. She really, really does. And
thank you.
Very, very talented. So.
So, and you know, I have another Ryan Chronicles book that's coming out. It's sort of like later after the Death Chronicles and stuff like that. That's Shadows and Fate.
Yep.
And then
I just want to pick that up right now.
Aha. Yeah, yes, exactly. And if you're in Kindle Unlimited, that's in Kindle Unlimited. So woo-hoo. Yes. And then just I haven't really figured out what other series I'm gonna start outside of the one with Katie. So that'll come out.
You're finally getting Katie to write again?
Yep. Yep, I finally set up the Google Drive for us with our covers and.
Yeah.
Thank
you. So Rebecca, it's kind of hard for me because I have a lot of different people I interview. So they're like, it kind of, No, I'm going to be straight with you guys. Like, this is my honest opinion. Katie is uberly talented. She has, I love her agent, her Magical Agent series is so good. Yes. It's really, really good. And she should definitely be doing a lot more.
Yeah, we had fun with the Running with the Devil, Running from the Devil series. That was a lot of fun writing with her. So we're gonna have fun doing, you know, I think Faye this time. Nice. So yes.
So nice.
That'll be fun.
Yeah, I am getting a new computer next week. That makes me happy because this computer is giving me all kinds of problems. Been doing it for a while now, so.
Like, oh yeah, I gotta get a new one before it dies, before it craps out on me.
That's pretty much it. Yeah, I know. Yeah. It's at the point now where I can't, how do I put this? It's at the point now where I can't do the fun stuff anymore. Mm-hmm. So like, for example, literally while we were doing this, it opened up a menu I didn't open up. It froze my system for like half a second there. I don't know if I disappeared or not. Mm-hmm. And now I don't know how I'm going to end the stream because it won't let me get to the place where I end the stream.
What about just leave? What about Control G?
Control G?
That's what it says when it says leave here. So
I'll do that. I do that, I guess. Well, except I have to end the stream first before I leave, right? So
Yes, that's probably a good idea.
That's true. So because my computer just basically said, hey, by the way, listen, I'm going to open this menu at this most inconvenient of time because Murphy's Law. Now I'm not quite sure how to end this. So, but you got a book coming out.
I got a book coming out. I've got the 1-10 fairy tales that came out too on ebook yesterday as well. So that's a beautiful cover. I was hoping to God I'd have hardcover today. Did you?
It finally cleared. Good.
but I was hoping I'd have the hardcover today, but no, Amazon told me that it's going to be another week.
Yeah.
Hardcovers, don't expect any hardcovers you order to come in any fast period of time.
No, I don't. So I'm going to be looking at making physical copies of my Alice. So I have, I have two books I have planned for like officially release, let's just say. Mm-hmm. And then I got like two unofficially I might release this year. I have a book I'm drawing, which scares the shit out of me. I have a Kickstarter golden storybook comic that's ready to essentially go outside. It needs to be lettered, but that's about it. I have to draw the cover to that too, which is like, oh my God, I'm drawing a cover. All right, but it's stick figures, so it's not all terrible. Right. And so I got those two. Those are the unofficial. The official one, I have to do a sequel to Alice. I also find the artist for Alice. Kenzie has decided that she wants to do other things, and that's totally cool. I totally get it. I was incredibly grateful that I got to work with her. She's amazing. Rebecca, and then probably. I would not be shocked about that. Right. Mm-hmm. I would not be legitimately shocked about that, but it also, this computer is about 4 years old. Mm-hmm. So
I'm not going to tell you how old mine is then.
Well, 5 years,
baby.
5 years is usually the shelf life of a computer. Yeah. It's shelf life. So I'm again, some of the problems I'm seeing right now just are like, I could probably fix these. Mine is months old. Rebecca, we're gonna talk about your system at some point when off the air, but because mine has lasted 4 years comfortable, and that's what all the USB stuff, like the system does not overheat very much actually.
Right.
It's got a decent little wind thing in there, but beyond all that, So I got plans, and then I'm trying to figure out how to take my show legitimately on the road. I'm debating about doing a Kickstarter for it. I'm not sure how I'm going to make that work, but that's kind of in the goal. So, but that all said, if I do come, if I do head your neck of the woods, it will probably be the fall-ish. I'm going to try to do it before winter because
Yes, because if it's fall-ish, then if it's after mid-October, I will be up here. If it's before mid-October, I will be at the beach.
It would be probably September, October, right? September, October.
At the end of September. I have a window in September that I'm not around because that's when my son is getting married.
Yeah, I got you.
Yeah.
So Rebecca, you missed it. I'm probably going to be doing a trip in Vancouver in June. Right. It's going to be my test run. That's the plan. I'm going to be test running my idea. I'm already quietly doing, I've actually recorded one secret show. I've already recorded one secret show so far, and I'm going to be hoping to do a couple more while I'm in Calgary, with the people here. But yeah, it's Vancouver will be June. Probably July is going to be California, Washington, and then August will hopefully be Arizona, Colorado. Mm-hmm. And then September will be Michigan, see my grandmother. And while I'm out there, we'll see if I can keep going Eastern. I have lots of friends all over, so it'll be fun. It'll be a fun journey. Looking forward to it. But yeah, it sounds like you're going to have a good plan. Sounds like you're going to see some more books from me this year. So yeah, I want to say this officially. You've been one of my favorite guests, honest to God. I had never imagined we'd get along so well. when I first met you, I wasn't so sure, but now that you've done
it. Oh my God, I don't know about her.
Well, no. The first time I saw it, it's like you again compared to now, right? You were locked. You started off quieter on Spilling Ink. You did.
Oh yeah.
So I didn't have really a good impression of what I was getting myself into. And after the first episode, oh my God, she's like an older version of me. Like in a lot of ways. So, you have been a pleasure. And
It is always a pleasure coming on this show, Josh.
Yeah. No, I just say, if I don't get another chance have you on the show before I wrap this up, I just wanted to thank you personally for everything you've done for me. So I just thank you.
You're welcome.
And good luck with everything this year. I hope you kick all kinds of ass.
I hope so too.
Yeah. So we've plugged everything. Do you want to tell people where they can find you before we wrap this up?
www.jetaylor75.com.
Awesome. Why 75?
July 5th.
Really?
It's my birthday.
Oh, okay. I've been wondering about that. So there you go.
Yeah, folks. No, July 5th. Yep. 75.
Okay. There you go. Last question of the show. So don't check out her website. Go check out her book. I promise you, she's an amazing, amazing author. Yeah. There you go. There you go, Rebecca. That will do it for this episode of Just Joshing Today. I will not be back till next week. I got a pretty cool lineup next week. I got Jemis Jokum. I got Lucy Leitner. I got there's another person. And name escapes me because I'm a trained professional and that's what I actually do. Trained motherfucker professional. But what I will do before I wrap this bad boy up is because I am, like I said, that trained. They gave me a reward for this, Jane. Give me a reward for this. So Jane can attest to this. I do advertising services, video, audio, words, and pictures about your projects or yourselves. I definitely help you engage your audience wherever they are, right? I'll help you figure it out how to do a campaign tailored to it. That's definitely what I do. Check out the website for more details. And if you got comic book work, I do that shit too. Anyways, folks, stay inspired. Keep shining in the dark. Becca, thanks for everything. Good luck with your COVID. Stay inspired. Keep shining in the dark. And I'll see you guys next time. Come on, button, hit. Control G.
It's like we're still live, people.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable. Again, is it not? I think I'm off the air.
It still says live.
Oh, good Lord.